Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, hamdun yuafi ni'am yukafi wa mazida. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, hamdun yuafi ni'am yukafi wa mazida. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, hamdun yuafi ni'am yukafi wa mazida. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We pray that everyone is well, inshallah, on such an auspicious night. It's not really befitting for me to speak, particularly in front of Shaykh Khalid Hassan, Allah bless him, inshallah, but we took his permission to say a few words, and likewise, we always benefit from the words of our dear brother, Muhyi Sunnah. Allah bless him, inshallah, for the efforts that he's been making throughout this month. Bless him, his family, his loved ones, and all those that are connected to him, inshallah. Ameen. From the words of Al-Mustafa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was what? Khayl qurun qarni. That the best of generations is my generation. And the best of generations, they have measurements, i.e. standards by which people are measured. You know, we have to ask ourselves in the societies that we belong to, how do we measure men? Is the imam of the masjid respected? Is the student of knowledge respected? Is the uncle that frequents the mosque respected? Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا رَأَيْتَ رَجُلٌ يَعْتَادِ الْمَسَاجِدِ فَاشْهَدْ لَهُ بِالْإِيمَانِ. If you see a man who frequents the mosque, you can bear witness that this person is a person of what? Iman. You see, it wasn't necessarily what the clothes people wore, the cars that they drive, the occupations that they have. They were measured by what? Religion in and of itself. And from the ways that the companions discerned certain people was based on this particular night, Yawm al-Furqan, the day of discernment. I separated many a man from a non-man. The people of Badr on this blessed night, mashallah, who sacrificed so that we could be people here today of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah by virtue of the sacrifice that they made for each and every single one of us. And it's not a simple statement to make. It's not a simple statement to make that we are only here, i.e. people of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, because of those 313 men that sacrificed everything so that we could be here today to be people of what? La ilaha illallah. This isn't the words of the faqir. This is the words of Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who stood up the whole night in prayer, hands raised up to the seven heavens, beseeching his Lord, saying what? Allahumma in tuhlik hadhi al-isaba fala tu'bad fil ard. Oh Allah, if you were to remove this small band of men, you would no longer be worshipped on this earth. So if it wasn't from those people who sacrificed, Rijal sadaqu ma'ahad Allah alayhi. These were men who were true to the pact or covenant they have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Men who sacrificed, men would weep if they didn't have the provisions of the like to sacrifice themselves in waging war campaigns alongside the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Tawallu, meaning they turn their backs. Wa ayunum tafidu bidam'i min al-hazan. That their eyes would weep profusely out of sadness of not engaging alongside the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even if we're to look at the children of that generation, children, 10-year-old, before they even reach the age of discernment or the age of pubescence, you know, 10-year-olds would be, they would, when they were called for these specific campaigns, they would stand tiptoe to make themselves look bigger so that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pick them. And if they turned away, they wept. The great companion Sayyidina Umayr ibn Abi Waqas, before again he was baligh, before he was pubescent, and he was turned away from the Battle of Badr, what does he do? He weeps. But does that suffice for him? No. He goes and he petitions the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to allow him by any means necessary to participate in the Battle of Badr. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave him permission to what? Just carry the swords. And now his boast is what, Sayyidina Umayr? He said that he goes up, and I attended the Battle of Badr carrying swords, and on my chin was only one hair, which goes to show how young he was, and I used to stroke that hair on my chin. That's his honor, his sharaf, that I attended what? The Battle of Badr. You know, years later, our teachers tell us a story about a man, a father, and look at the relationship between fathers and sons, that he's going to wage war on a particular campaign, and he's walking with his son is 10 years old. And before he enters into the battle, he looks to his 10-year-old son and says what? He goes, do you have a message for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Meaning what? His intention is to go and to not return back. And he's telling that to his 10-year-old son. What's the response from his 10-year-old son? He goes, Ya Abati, O my father, I'm going to ask you the same question because I made the same intention you made. Age of what? 10. 10. Children. Or rather, Rijal. I don't think the men of today measure up to the children of that time. But don't forget, those children are what? Products of mothers. Right? Those children, those understandings of mafahim, are products of mothers who reared them. We can speak about the great Khawla bint al-Azwar, right? And who she produced. We can speak about the likes of Sayyidina Safiya bint Abdul Muttalib, that there's no Zubayr ibn al-Awam without what the rearing of Sayyidina Safiya bint Abdul Muttalib, right? Or we can speak about Sayyidina Usayba bin Ka'b, who in a particular campaign in the Battle of Uhud, the Prophet said what? He goes, Maltafattu yameen wa la shimada. Never did I look to my right or my left. Illa ara Umara tuqatilu duni. Everywhere I look, Umara, Nusayba bin Ka'b is fighting by my side. A woman who what? And her and her family, the Prophet had a supplication. Allahumma ijalhum rafaqai fil jannah. Oh Allah, make, meaning Nusayba and her family, my companions were in heaven. The companions used to what? Pray for his companionship in Jannah. He's praying for the companionship of who? This blessed woman. Again, we don't have men that measure up to these particular women. And we can go on. If that's what the children were like, and if that's what the women were like, then what about the men? What about the rijal sadaqu ma'ahadallah alayhi? Men that are true to this contract that they have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can speak about the greats like Sayyidina Abu Dujana. Then he would wear a particular turban amongst the Ansar. And this turban was known as what? Imamat al-Maut. Right? The turban of death. Meaning what? Again, I'm going, I'm not coming back. We can speak about, like we said, the product of Sayyidina Safiya, Sayyidina Zubayr ibn al-Awam. They said when you looked at a distance on Sayyidina Ubayr and his torso was exposed, they said it looked like there were eyes all over his torso from the amount of stab wounds that he had on his body, fighting alongside Sayyid al-Khalq sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the books of Sirah, they mentioned that once he was up against an enemy, struck the enemy in half, and accidentally split him in half, and accidentally cut the horse in half. And they say, Ya Zubayr, that's a sword that you've got. He goes, it's not the sword, it's the arm. Right? Rijal. We can speak about the great Sayyidina Imam Ali, Karamallahu wajhahu, who when the Prophet ﷺ would engage in particular campaigns, he would say what to Sayyidina Ali? There's 300 men over there, Ali, you take care of them. 300 men. Mentioned in the books of Sirah. Right? Mentioned in the books of Sirah. Or when he broke his shield on a particular campaign. And so he rips off a door from one of the fortresses. And he uses that as a shield for the duration of a battle. He casts it aside. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar said what? He goes, 8 of us tried to lift that door. We couldn't even flip it. And then what does it mean when this Haydar, this lion says what? إِذَا كَشَفَ الْحَرْبَ سَاقِهَا كُنَّا نَتَّقِي بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ. That when the shin of war was exposed, we would seek refuge behind who? Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyid al-Khalq sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What does that mean about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? But what lessons do we learn him on the night, on the precursor to the Battle of Badr? May Allah be pleased with him. Right? We learn humility. That en route to the Battle of Badr, they had limited munitions, limited mounts. And so he... they're sharing like 3 men to a camel or 3 men to a horse. And he's with Sayyidina Marthad, Ibn Abi Marthad, and Sayyidina Ali. May Allah be pleased with them. And so they dismount, and then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mounts. And on riding, he now dismounts, so it's their turn. They say, Ya Rasulullah, carry on. Meaning, how can we ride up whilst you are walking beside us? What does he say? Ma antum aqwa minni. Okay, you two aren't stronger than me. I can walk just as you can walk. But then what does he say? Just as you need the reward, I need the reward too. La ilaha illallah. Just as you need the reward, I need the reward too. Humility. Sayyid al-Khalq, look at the humility of this individual. Now the Prophet has certainty about what? An-Nasr min Allah wa fatun qareeb. But again we said what? The night of Badr, his hands are what? Extended to the 7 heavens. Sayyidina Ali, karamallahu wajhu, said what? He goes that I was coming in and out of sleep, gazing upon the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hands raised to the 7 heavens, just weeping, weeping, beseeching his Lord. In those things are what? Lessons for us. You have problems in your life, get up before Fajr. You have issues with your wife or your husband, get up before Fajr. You have financial worries or the likes, get up before Fajr. And beseech your Lord. All of your problems will be resolved, inshallah, in those hours just before dawn. And when the Prophet ﷺ is raising his hands to the seven heavens, Sayyidina Abu Bakr says to him, what? قَدْ أَلَحْتَ عَلَى رَبِّكَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Meaning it's enough, you've truly beseeched your Lord. It's enough. He stood up the whole night in prayer. Again, no standing that night, no people today of La ilaha illa Muhammad Rasulullah. None. Tayyib, is his prayer at that time was because of any type of doubt in his mind? No. Why? Because the next day, what does he say? Hada masra fulan wa hada masra fulan. That's where so-and-so is going to die. He names the enemies and tell them exactly where they're going to fall on the battlefield. Again, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar said what? He goes, we perused the battlefield after, and wherever the Prophet said so-and-so would fall, he fell in that exact position. In the morning, what does he say? Ya abshir ya Abu Bakr. Right? Be happy, Abu Bakr. Fahada Jibreel, and this is Gabriel, akhidhan bi inan farasi, he's holding the reins to his horse, Hayzum. Wa alayhi ahlat al-harb. And he's dressed for war. Right? He's dressed for war. It's not good odds. You're going up against Gabriel and he's dressed for war. It's not good odds. Right? Absolute yaqeen. But these things are what? This humility are examples for us. And we can speak about the many, and this is upon us. Our children, our mothers, our wives, our brothers, our sisters, our parents should be au fait with the story of Badr. That we should know those names. Allah bless our dear Muhyi Sunnah and Shaykh Khalid who recited the Jaliyat al-Qadr before Maghrib. Those names that we should all know. Those are the names we should know, not the names of any type of football star, any type of whoever. Those are the names that should be what? Manifest on one's tongue. And we look at all the various miracles, and you can speak about the miracles. The likes of Sayyidina Uqash ibn Mahsan, who when his sword broke, he comes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why is he coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They know how many munitions they had, weapons they had. Because he knows he's not coming to an ordinary man. Or the likes of Sayyidina Salama, likewise, Ya Rasulullah, our sword is broken. So he throws these branches in the direction, Jahid bihada. And those branches turn into swords from from the blessings of Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We can speak about Sayyidina Khubayb ibn Yasaf, who when he's waging war, he goes, that my left shoulder was severed, so my arm was dangling off. And I'm waging war, and I put my foot on my arm to rip it off so I could go carry on, because it was bothering me. And then again, he knows that he's not coming to an ordinary human being, because he takes his arm to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he reattaches it to his blessed shoulder. We can speak about Sayyidina Qatada, whose eye was taken out by an arrow. Again, coming to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who applies his blessed saliva and reattaches the eye. And it's better than it was before. We can speak about all these things. We speak about what? We can speak about how this was the most arduous, difficult day upon who is Shaytan. Ma min yawmin, ma ru'i Shaytan. The devil has never seen a day. Yani adhar aghyad, when he's more vexed or belittled than what? Yawm al-Arafah, except for the day of Badr. And we can go on and we can go on and we can go on, but what we have to understand is what? When we look at the lifetime, the life and times of who? The companions. It's like love letters to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That when they saw arrows or the like cast in his blessed direction, they would run up and literally fling their bodies into the air to catch those things, rather than any single thing touch the blessed body of Al-Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of those manifestations would what? Who? Sayyidina Su'ad ibn Ghaziyah. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells the companions to make lines. And Sayyidina Su'ad is just in front of the line. And so the Prophet, he has an arrow in his hand, and he prods Sayyidina Su'ad ibn Ghaziyah in the stomach, and he goes, get back in line. Sayyidina Su'ad says what? He goes, Al-Qisas ya Rasulullah, I want retribution, revenge. He goes, what? He goes, you hurt me. So the Prophet, he puts the arrow in the hand of Sayyidina Su'ad, raises his shirt, and he goes, take your revenge. Sayyidina Su'ad throws the arrow down, he grabs the Prophet and he rubs his face in the blessed flesh of Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Su'ad ma hamala ala dhalika. O Su'ad, what caused you to do this? Ya Rasulullah, you see what we're before. 313 men up against 1,000. If this is the last time we meet, I want my flesh to touch your flesh. See what I mean? Prior to death, what concerns them? Any opportunity to get close to the Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the companions' lifetimes are literally letters of love to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even in battle, or more so, especially in battle. We pray that our existences here are a fraction of love or manifestations of love for him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That on this blessed night, by the barakah of those 313 men, Allah accept each and every single one's prayer, each and every single one's dhikr, each and every single one's qira'ah of Quran. You know, that Allah bless our dear brothers and sisters in this community that do so much for us, so that we just come here and we drink tea and coffee, and you know, I'm waiting for my milkshake, to be honest with you. It's usually here. They know I don't like mango, so now they bring the strawberry one. I put in about half a stone, I think, in this tarawih, which I don't know if it's a good thing or a bad thing, right? But we ask for Allah, inshallah, to bless this community with more than they hope for. Not what they hope for, right? That more than the helpful, solely by the blessings of such a night. Wa jazakallahu khair wa rahmatukum.